Today we are interviewing Dean William Spitzer, who came to USC in 1963, and before he retired held many positions, including Dean of Letters, Arts, and Science, and Acting Provost. Before we start, however, I should tell the viewer that I am privileged to be Dean Spitzer's son. My name is Matthew Spitzer. All right. Before we start with the time during which you were at USC, could you give the viewer a little bit of background on yourself about the time before you came to USC?
I'd be glad to. First of all, I'm very proud to be interviewed by my son. I was born in Los Angeles, native son, was educated primarily here through college. My first association with USC was as a graduate student from 1949 through 1952. I was a graduate student in the Department of Physics at USC, received a master's here, then worked for a year at Hughes, and then went to Purdue University for the doctorate. After Purdue University, I worked for 5 years at Bell Telephone Laboratories in semiconductor research, left there to return to California at Bell and Howell for 1 year, and then started at USC. And that was in July 1963 that my association with the university started as a professor.
Can you tell us how and why you decided to come to USC at that point?
I had received two offers from other universities, well-known universities, and
we're among friends. You can tell us their names.
Okay. One was Stanford, the other was Caltech. And I was seriously considering the Caltech offer. I had already decided that Stanford, because of some other factors, was not a good match for me. The year I spent working at Bell and Howell was a very difficult year for me because Bell and Howell, between the time I interviewed and I started to work there, had pretty much changed directions in terms of what their research enterprise was going to be. And so I spent almost 70% of my time that year at Caltech working with Professor Carver Mead on aspects of semiconductor surface barrier units, what determined the surface barrier height. So I was thinking that I was going to go to Caltech, and my wife, your mother, likes to tell the story of how I left one morning saying I was going to go to Caltech and came home that evening telling her that I had changed my mind and was probably going to go to USC. What happened was I received a telephone call during that day from a man by the name of Zurab Kaprilian, who was at that time the department chair of the School of Engineering. And it was about a 2 to 3 hour conversation in which Zurab touched on a number of issues which had concerned me about going to Caltech. He himself had been at Caltech for 2-3 years as a postdoctoral research associate. And he told me some of what he was thinking of for USC. And it sounded to me like USC was going to be a really terrific opportunity, a place where I could make a difference. I didn't really think I was going to make any difference at Caltech, and where I'd have a chance to build, to do something, to make something which was really, at that time, not a very good university, much better. And I decided to go to USC to take a chance. It was primarily having faith in Zurab as a person. I did some checking around, of course, and I found that his word could be trusted. So I came here on an act of faith.
You joined the Department of Electrical Engineering, obviously, when Dr. Zorab Kaprielian was the chair. Can you describe the development of the School of Engineering and whether or not your hopes for it succeeded?
It developed extremely well. I think everything he told me came to pass. Zorab was, in my mind, a genius. He had a plan for the School of Engineering. It was not long after I came that he became dean of the School of Engineering, so it became easier for him to implement those plans. The School of Engineering at that time had a large student population, had very little in the research area, and had a faculty which was okay but not great. Zorab realized in order to build the School of Engineering, he had to really attack on four fronts. He needed to bring in outstanding faculty. He needed to bring in outstanding students. He had to bring in research funds, and he had to improve facilities in a major way. The first step that he made, and this was before I even came, was he managed to convince the joint services, Army, Navy, Air Force, to invest in what's called a JSEP program at USC, Joint Services Electronics Program. And this provided blanket funding for researchers working in the area, the general area of electronics and communications. It was a rather sizable contract. It ran on a cycle. I'm not sure, but I think maybe the university still has that program. That enabled him to attract some faculty because he could tell faculty who were coming in, who were research-oriented, that he could provide some initial funding for them to set up their laboratories, provide student support funds, graduate student support funds, to get their program going. It was still up to the faculty members to bring in external funding themselves. Not long after that, he was successful in bringing through the School of Engineering, the group as a whole, but Zorab was very much the leader. He brought in a National Science Foundation Center of Excellence grant. That grant built Seaver with a contribution from the Seavers, built Seaver Science Hall, supplied a major shot in the arm of equipment, major equipment for the laboratories, and for a period of, I think it was a total of either 5 or 7 years, provided funding for individual faculty members. So that's what he did on the front for facilities and for bringing in funds. To bring in graduate students, 1 year he went to Caltech and interviewed every graduating student in the electrical engineering department. He brought somewhere between a third and a half of that class to USC. It was incredible. The first two graduate students that I had were from that class, and excellent students. It wasn't just the lower half or third of the class. He brought two out of the top five graduates. So there was suddenly a flow in of very good graduate students. And he was a master at bringing faculty. With all of this happening at the same time, he recruited a number of people into the School of Engineering, primarily the Department of Electrical Engineering, to build that department up. The faculty increased in number and in quality tremendously. Bell Telephone Laboratories, which is a premier research laboratory in the area of electronics and communications, was going through some difficult times at that point, some reshuffling of personnel. And at one time, we were successful in bringing, I think it was 10 faculty members from Bell Laboratories into the area of electrical engineering. They were all good people. And there were one or two that came into the physics department as well. So he upgraded the faculty substantially. He upgraded the graduate students. He created a research environment, provided some, at least some initial funding for it. And there were three new engineering buildings built, one of the main ones being the Seaver Science Hall for engineering, which and solid state sciences, which provided research facilities for the people. So I think all of the accolades that people over the years have given Zareb for what he did were well deserved.
You mentioned that in the 1970s, a couple of scientists came from Bell Laboratories to the physics department. It was during that period of time, the 1970s, when you moved from the School of Engineering to the physics department and became chair. Can you explain how that happened and describe what happened in the physics department?
Sure. In the School of Engineering, shortly, well, within about 3 years after I came, we created a Department of Material Science. I was the founding chairman of that department. The purpose, or one of the mission of that department was at the graduate level. It did not have an undergraduate department. It was only a graduate department. And its mission at that point was to do primarily work on electronic materials, materials of electronic interest. There were some people in the department who worked on more classical metallurgical areas, but mostly it was semiconductor electronics. That put me in a position to be a bridge between physics and electrical engineering, because that field incorporates physics, chemistry, and engineering. When I was chair of that department, the physics department was going through some difficult times. It had a chair that the department was becoming increasingly unhappy with, and he, after he had completed a five-year term, the department decided not to have him renew as a chair. But they were in an awkward position that they didn't have anyone in the department that they were happy with moving into the chairmanship. And so I was approached by the physics department with a request to move from material science to physics and become the chair. I remember I was worried about doing it, because having been a student there, it's sometimes not a good idea to move into a department where you have been a graduate student. Once a student, always a student. And I was also concerned about leaving engineering. And I had a long conversation with Zareb about it, and Zareb was very much in favor of my moving because he felt it would help physics. So I did make the move. And I remember the first year I was chairman of the department, I was in a rather unique position since I didn't hold an appointment in the department. When the department realized what the problem was, that was rectified. But so I was chair of the physics department for 3 years. Then another person became chair, and then I was co-chair again for another 3 years. The physics department at that time improved, I think, significantly. There were a number of people who came in who were very good. But I think we have to understand we're talking about a department of between 20 and 23 faculty. You're competing with departments that are two and three times the size. It meant that you couldn't cover all fields. We made a conscious decision to cover really only three areas in physics in depth. And we were very good in those three areas, but there are areas in which we were almost totally void personnel. As a result, the department on a national basis never rated very highly. It was around in the 50s on a national scale. But that was much better than it had been. Unfortunately, one of the areas that we could not cover at that time was high energy physics. And it was true that that was at the top of the pecking order in the physics discipline. And if you didn't have anything there, you weren't going to be a top-rated department.
Also, during the 1970s, the university was considering the creation of a Middle East Center, and you had some sort of a central role in evaluating the Middle East Center and what ultimately happened to it. Can you tell the viewers something about the Middle East Center and what your role was?
Some of the details are a little fuzzy in my memory. But basically, the first I knew about the proposed Middle East Center was a report that appeared in the press saying that the university was considering a Middle East Center. Then not long after it came to light that the university was considering this, there was a meeting, a faculty meeting, held in which the president of the university, Zoreb, who at that time was executive vice president, and the dean of LAS presented what it was that was being proposed.
And what was that?
Well, as it turned out, when we plumbed into it, because I won't attempt to repeat what they said, but what really came to light was an attempt to create a university within a university. They were going to create a Middle East Study Center which would have its own admissions. The university would have nothing to say, the university in general, would have nothing to say about admissions. Its own curriculum, the university would have no right of approval or disapproval of the curriculum. They would hire their own faculty using their own criteria. They would have their own administration. And the only linkage between this center and USC proper, that is the rest of the university, would be a governing board on which there sat three members appointed by this center or the governing board, because the funds, there were funding ties, which I have to mention, and three members of USC. That was the only place that there was a link up. The funding for this Middle East Center was not coming from USC, but was coming from countries in the Middle East, particularly those that did business with Saudi Arabia, oil business, and that some of the people in the Saudi government would be asking these companies to make major contributions to the USC Middle East Center for its funding. When these facts came to light, then the Faculty Senate had a major meeting on it and expressed grave doubts about whether USC should have such a center.
To clarify things, the USC name was to be on the Middle East Center?
Yes.
Okay.
It was to be, as far as anyone externally looking, part of USC. There had already been preliminary approval by the Board of Trustees. It was not approval in the sense that they had voted to approve it, but they had voted that it was worth considering. Some of the members of the Faculty Senate made contact with members of the Board of Trustees, and when the board became some of the members of the board, when they became aware of what the conditions were, decided that they want to pursue a further study of whether it was advisable to do this. So they asked the president to set up a committee to investigate the proposal. A committee was formed. I was a member of that committee. The dean of the law school at that time, Dorothy Nelson, was a member of the committee. Carl Crystal, who was, I believe, in political science, but also held a law degree, was a member of the committee. There were maybe three other members, I can't recall. Oh, and from the board of, there was a member from the board of trustees, John McCone, of the McCone Commission. We had a number of interviews with people, and when we were all done, there was a virtually unanimous decision on the part of the committee that we should recommend that we not have the Middle East Center under the conditions that it was being proposed. Having a Middle East Study Center was worthwhile having, but as a normal part of the regular university, subject to all the conditions and restrictions that any other academic unit in the university is subject to. That killed it because on that basis, no external people were willing to fund it.
During the 1970s and 1980s, you developed something called the Spitzer profile. And I might add that when I meet people, even today, and I tell them my name, Matthew Spitzer, on occasion, the first thing out of their mouths is, Spitzer profile? Can you tell us a little bit about what the Spitzer profile was and how it came about?
It's funny that you have that experience, because I still remember many years after the time of the Spitzer profile, I met a junior faculty member who, when she heard my name, she said, are you any relation to the Spitzer profile? And I said, yes, I was the author of that. And I guess she was very surprised, because she exclaimed, you're still alive? Viewed as ancient history. There was a period where there was a lot of publicity about UCLA. Some members of the faculty at UCLA who were not involved in the teaching programs at UCLA and seemed to be faculty who worked at a distance with the central missions that you'd expect a university to have. And the Board of Regents at UCLA was demanding an investigation. And the Board of Trustees at USC, some of them were picking up on this and were asking the same questions about USC. We're saying, well, they're having this problem, but we'd like to know what is the situation at USC. And just parenthetically, I also found many people who did not understand at all what in my view and in most people's view on the campus, what the role of a professor really is. The whole portion of the professor's time and effort that goes into research and scholarly activities is something that was very hard for them to understand. They tended to view a faculty member at USC the same way they view someone who teaches in elementary or junior high school. I found this with my own sister, who was a longtime teacher at the junior high school level, didn't really understand what the role of a university professor was. Well, a committee was formed called the Faculty Load Committee, Faculty Load Profile Committee. I was chair of that committee, and it was formed really defensively. The Board of Trustees were asking these questions, so what we wanted to do was to create something that the Board of Trustees could see, which the faculty could see, which more properly defined the role of a faculty member. And what it was essentially an algorithm that put together the three parts of the main parts of a faculty member's responsibilities.
An algorithm being a formula?
A formula. It talked about teaching, about research and scholarly work, and it talked about service to the university and the community. And put together a kind of view as to what a faculty member in typical fashion should be doing, how much time should be devoted to each of these things, some flexibility so that different faculty who were more gifted in one area than another area could focus more of their efforts. It had something in it about accountability. A person just couldn't do research with no accountability. His colleagues had to be able to judge that what he was doing was worthwhile. Even though it may not be what they're interested in doing, it was something that was legitimate research. And that when you put this all together, it made a faculty profile. Well, because I was chair of the committee, it became known as the Spitzer profile. And that was its origin. We presented it to the Faculty Senate. There was a spirited discussion on it, and I'm still proud to this day that it was passed unanimously by the Faculty Senate. In those days, the Faculty Senate was fairly contentious on almost all issues. To get something passed unanimously, it was unusual.
You must have been a persuasive speaker.
I must have been.
During the 1980s, you held several positions in central administration, moved around between several of them. Can you tell us a bit about the positions you held and what moved you to go into central administration?
In the 1980s, I had been a researcher and a teacher for many years. And I felt I had an interest and some abilities in the area of administration. And I was interested in doing something new. This, I know, feelings that you yourself have expressed as doing something different. And I always thought of this as being one of the major perks of being a professor at a university. You could emphasize research, you could emphasize teaching, you could emphasize service, and you could emphasize administrative work. And I felt there was a need for good administrative work at the university. I started out becoming the Dean of Science. I was not ready to give up my research completely at that point, and I realized very quickly after being Dean of Science for the first year, the Dean of Science was a position within the College of Letters, Arts, and Sciences, that in order to do the job properly, I'd have to do it full time. So I dropped out of that position after 1 year because my research laboratory, I just wasn't ready to give it up. After a few years, I was ready at that point to make the transition, and I became Dean of the Graduate School and Vice Provost for Research. After being in that position for a couple of years, there was a crisis in the College of Letters, Arts, and Sciences. The person who had been dean, his name was Chet Lieb, was summarily relieved of his position as dean of the college. He was a professor of the Department of Philosophy, so he returned to the Department of Philosophy, but was no longer dean of the college. There was a tremendous controversy in the university because many people felt that Chet Lieb was an outstanding dean. But there were problems between himself, between Chet, and members of the central administration, in particular the president, who was Jim Zumberg at the time, and the provost, who was Neil Pings. Chet Lee maintained that he never knew why he was relieved of his position, whereas the president and Neil Pings both maintained that he knew very well why he was relieved of it. This was a controversy which never really was resolved.
As I recall, there was an article in the Daily Trojan about this, suggesting that it was a chain of command problem.
That is one part, and a second part is that there can only be one university president. He apparently had made contact with some of the members of the board and was acting in a presidential way rather than as the dean of the college. And I think President Zumberg felt he was undermining his authority. At that point, they needed a dean of the college. So they asked me to become the acting dean of the college, which I did. It was not a very pleasant situation, as you can well imagine. All of the administrative help sitting in the college office felt bonded to Chet Lieb, and I was coming in as the outsider. This included three deans who reported to Chet Lieb, the dean of social sciences, the dean of the humanities, and the dean of sciences. It included their staffs. It included the budget officer for the college. And I stepped in to a fairly hostile environment. They were nice about it. They didn't take it out on me personally, but they were hostile to the situation. By the time the first year had passed, that hostility had died away pretty much, and I was asked to assume the position on a permanent basis, which I did for three more years. So I was the dean of the College of LAS for a total of 4 years. After that ended, then I went back to being a professor again.
Do you believe in your various roles in central administration you managed to make a difference, both to education and teaching? And if so, what happened?
I think I did. There were many policies within the College of Letters, Arts, and Sciences, because there were three really different divisions that were not clear to members of the faculty, were not clear to members of the administration. Policies regarding how faculty were to be treated, joint appointments, evaluation of research, that I think I was able to clarify a great deal for members of the faculty. There were steps that were taken that I think improved both faculty morale and faculty productivity. The whole concept of giving a person who was coming up against tenure consideration a semester in which they had no responsibilities other than working on their scholarly output, scholarly work, was something which I put into effect. Did not exist before then. So there were a number of steps I think I took. There were other steps which were taken, particularly as dean of the graduate school. One of the things that became very clear to me very quickly was that there was a great difference between student financial support for graduate students and for undergraduate students. The undergraduate student support came directly out of the direct budget of the university. There was nothing like it for the graduate students. And as a result, graduate students' support was something that was left really pretty much up to the individual departments. If the departments had teaching assistantships to offer, and they had people in the department who were doing research, funded research, so that they would have funds for research assistantships, then that would perhaps work all right for that department. But there are departments where that isn't true. Many departments where all they have is teaching assistantships, and so people tended to be in teaching assistantships for many years. It also made it very difficult to attract really top-flight graduate students. So what I did was I put together a study of the quality and characteristics of the graduate students, not only in the College of Letters, Arts, and Sciences, but also in many of the professional schools. And I showed at that point that there was a considerable difference between some of the public rhetoric that we used and the actual student quality measures. And I had I remember very clearly to this day that I had a hearing with the provost and with the chief financial officer of the university. And when I got done, they looked at one another and they said, well, very clearly, we're not doing the right thing. We've got to put money into graduate student support. And we then took a program which was a very small program within the graduate school of graduate student support and expanded it to eventually coming close, I think, to 100 research-oriented fellowships for students that would last for 3 years. The amount of funds were sufficient to handle all of their needs, and where in order to qualify for it, they would have to have the kind of examination scores and undergraduate records that would qualify them for entrance to the premier universities in the country. So it wound up we had something like, I think the top number was between 80 and 100, first class graduate students, typically with GREs above 1450. And if you average out in PhD programs, these were PhD programs primarily, but not just the College of Letters, Arts, and Sciences, the PhD programs in the basic sciences at the medical school, the PhD program in social work, the PhD program in public administration. And if you figure out with 80 students, you get one to two of these students per program, and we felt it could have a substantial impact on the program. There's a drag effect. You bring in real good students, other real good students consider coming, and it also provides a prod to the program. So, yes, I think it had an impact.
You retired in 1992, but if someone were to look at your resume, one would notice that you were acting provost in 1993. How did this come about?
Neil Pings was the provost, and he was the provost for almost all of Jim Zumberg's years as president. He continued being provost once President Sample took the presidential office. But it was clear he was not going to remain. I believe it was in around mid to late 1992 that Neil Pings announced that he was leaving USC to become president of the AAU, that's the American Association of Universities. So there had to be a search for a new provost. It was also clear that Neil was going to leave soon enough that that we couldn't bring in a new provost quickly enough to assume the position and do a thorough enough search the way we felt we should do it. So at that point, Sample decided that we needed President Sample of the university decided that we should have an acting provost until the search process could be completed. And he made the decision to approach me to ask me to fill in this position. There were, I think, two reasons why he did it. Number one, I think he felt comfortable with my doing it. That was probably most important to him. But secondly, he also wanted someone in the position who was not going to be a candidate for the position. I had already retired. I was no longer an active member of the faculty. It was clear I was not going to be a candidate for a 5-year term as provost. And so he asked me to assume the position, and although it was called acting provost, he made it quite clear he wanted me to be the provost for whatever time it took to complete the search. This, I became the provost roughly February of 93, and the new provost, who was appointed as a result of the search, I think assumed his duties, if I remember correctly, in September of that year, 1993. So there was a period of about 2/3 to 3/4 of a year that I was the provost. And that's how it came about. It was a very demanding position. Anyone who holds that position has a great deal of respect from me, because it's the tendency that was used at that time, or the arrangement that was used at that time, was that every dean in the college, every dean in the university, including the 4 deans of the college, reported directly to the provost. It was not a very efficient management style.
My memory is that it was a very difficult time for the university in terms of the budget.
It was a difficult time for the university in terms of the budget. It was also a difficult time between President Sample and the university faculty. There was an adjustment period that was going on there. I think President Sample did realize at one point in a meeting that he made some statements that the faculty took umbrage with, and so there was a hostile faculty. There was a president who felt that he was being misinterpreted in what he had said, probably was. It was necessary to hold these things together so that it didn't become highly inflammatory. I think I was able to do that. And the budget, during the time that I was dean of LAS, the budget was fairly tight, but it became much worse after I was dean of LAS through the university as a whole. And yes, there were some very lean years. We were at that point in some units cutting back on numbers of faculty significantly. Also, entering class sizes took a drop in that period.
During your years at USC, who would you say were the half dozen or so people who made the biggest difference to the university and why? I mean, I presume that from your previous discussion that Zorab Kaprielian would be one of them.
Yes, he certainly would be. I think I would name 3 of the presidents who held the position while I was here. I think Norman Topping, who really started things rolling. It's interesting because there was an article recently about President Sample in the magazine section of the Los Angeles Times, what, about 3-4 weeks ago? And I don't think the author of that article did his homework. The accolades he gave President Sample were well deserved. I certainly have no questions about that. And the comments he made about Jim Zumberg's period of presidency before Sample's, I think, were also reasonably accurate. But he missed the whole period before. I think that the changes which are culminating in what you see today started with Norman Topping. Norman Topping had the first major fundraising campaign, and he was the person who gave certain people within the university, gave them their permission to go ahead and build with his backing. And without that, I don't think things could have been done. And I think we would have been in a much worse state entering the Zumberg and then Sample years if Topping had not taken that approach. It was a very entrepreneurial approach. I think Jim Zumberg, it's kind of funny, when he started as president, I didn't think he was going to be a very good president. He turned out to be very good. He did several things for this university which were, I think, very substantial. Number one, he gave a solidity to the office. He was a person who did not move rapidly on things. It gave a rock-like mooring to the university, and we needed it at that time. He had very little use for any aspect of religious or racial prejudice. And USC, in its very early years, prior to the time that I came here, had the reputation for not being very friendly on both a religious and racial basis. It was known as being an anti-Semitic institution. Zumberg really turned that around. A lot of that had dropped away already, but he had two or three major meetings with the leaders of the West Side Jewish community, attempting to point out to them that this was not the university that had been 20, 30 years before. He came down very hard on Fraternity Row when there were a couple of incidents of a racial, religious aspect in which he brooked no nonsense. I was very pleased to see that he did that, whereas the chancellor of UCLA did not take such action at UCLA when similar events happened.
You're referring to Charles Young.
Yes, I am. And also during Zumberg, there was another major campaign that was carried out and completed. I think the third one is Sample. Sample is without doubt the greatest fundraiser I have ever seen in action. He's incredible. And the major gifts that he's brought in are well documented. I mean, I attribute those to Sample, not to USC, but Sample as a person was instrumental in bringing those in. I think what Sample has done for the undergraduate program at USC has been remarkable. He focused right away on improving the quality of the undergraduate student and making sure that once we got good students in, that we retained them. He was very upset about the USC retention figures at that time. And I think it's well documented also. The increases in the entering SAT scores of the students. He's done for the undergraduate program what I think Zurab Kaprielian attempted to do in engineering for the graduate program. So I think Sample has had a tremendous impact and continues to have it on the university. Besides these three presidents, and Zurab Kaprielian would be a fourth one, the other two that I would think of to round out to six, I think Bob Biller is a person I would put in that category. Biller was the executive vice provost for many years, to Neil Pings. I know he was tremendously influential in the university at that time. But Biller also had the ability to fill in many different ways throughout the university when the need arose. He was the dean of admissions for years. He was the vice president in charge of external relations for many years. He was the dean of public administration. Because of his role in public administration, he had a large number of outside contacts, particularly in Washington and in Sacramento. So he served the university very well in that area. So I think in terms of operation of the university and meeting needs where needs existed, Biller was incredible in the things that he did. The last person is a surprise to me, but I think a person that I would put down, and her name is Karen Siegel. Karen Siegel was the person who created, managed, and maintained the academic quality of the what was called thematic option, the undergraduate honors program at the university. And I think that was very important.
When was this
for building? This covered a span of perhaps 20 years. And what that did was bring in really outstanding students at the undergraduate level, freshmen. And for their first year to 2 years, they were given programs that were the equal of any throughout the country. It got rave notices. She never got the recognition she probably deserved, but I think that served as the building block for building the undergraduate population that we apparently have today, judging at least by the scores. But I would meet members of the faculty whose children had come to USC and gone to thematic option, who would rave to me about how great thematic option was. It was a true honors program. I think those are the six people I think of in terms of the university in general. Now, of course, there are a lot of people who had tremendous influence within their individual areas. Your predecessor as dean of the law school, Scott Bice, I think certainly is an example of that. Scott has been tremendously important. I think Len Silverman, dean of the School of Engineering. But the people I've mentioned, I think, covered more of the total university and their influence.
Before we end, is there anything else you would like to add?
Well, nothing more, I think, except to say that I appreciate the opportunity to have this interview. I think the Emeriti College is to be congratulated for doing it, and I hope someone watches it sometime.
Me too.
Thanks, Dad. This has been fun. Maybe in 25 years, you can interview me.